Yuletide carols being sung by a choir, and folks dressed up like Eskimos. Everybody knows a turkey and some mistletoe help to make the season bright. Tiny tots
Christmas to you. Boy, this is a wonderful day, a wonderful way to begin today's show. Merry Christmas, Fei-Fei. Merry Christmas, Sasha. Merry Christmas, Joe Mama. Merry Christmas, House on Church Avenue. Merry Christmas to the world. Hey, I know you're spending a lot of money trying to make it be better, and you know, if you don't have a lot of money, it's still going to be better, and having a lot of money ain't going to make it be better. You got to look somebody in the eye, realize that, you know, we share this planet together. And if I treat you good, maybe you'll feel good enough to treat somebody else good. Doesn't have to be me that you treat good, but let's pass it on. Let's pass the spirit on. There is a tremendous spirit for Christmas. Oh, man, just to think about somebody caring enough about you to give their life. Thank you, Jesus. But at the same time, we have an obligation about how we live our lives. So once again, Merry Christmas. I would like that the Christmas spirit, the spirit of giving, the spirit of forgiving, the spirit of caring about someone other than yourself. You know, they say it's time, my brother, to love your brother for something other than what he can do for you. It's time to make our master wish come true. It's time for us to stand up straight, give a hand, or whatever it may take to help to free, elevate our fellow man. Oh, it's much too late to cry. We've all seen too many loved ones die. But we move forward. We constantly move forward. And that's what the beauty of life is about. Every time one goes out the door, we should be looking for another one. And as we get older in life, we should be trying to find younger spirits to pass our wisdom on to. I should say your wisdom. I don't know if I've moved into that realm of wisdom yet, but I'm certainly willing to talk to young people. Today is very special, as is every day. But this day brings us a little closer to that point in our minds where we're willing to, you know, we're going to slow down a little bit. This is Christmas Eve. We're going to slow down a little bit. We're going to take Christmas Day tomorrow and celebrate the Christ birth. Many of us are going to celebrate the big check. You know, time is taking us away from, I hate to say taking us away, because it's always taking us towards something else. So a choice. I'm sure you remember some great things that have happened in the past as you look forward to great things happening in the future. And you probably remember a few of the things that weren't so great, as we are obligated to do if we want to make things better, if we want to improve. Empire Talks Back to you is brought to you by the Improve Association, where our concern is that business and community comes together to improve our quality of life, to improve our ability to get along with each other. So, I'd like to invite a hello from Mr. Michael Harris. He is our historian. He is our new friend, which makes him an old friend. Michael, how are you this morning?
You know, I am very happy to be breathing oxygen on this Christmas Eve.
That's a good thing. That's a very good thing. You know what happens after Christmas Eve is Christmas Day. What happens after Christmas Day is something that I'd like for you to give us a bit of a history lesson on, a little bit of a cultural viewpoint. We have a need many times to explore, to invent, to create a pillow for our cultural selves, create a crisis intervention, to create our stress relief. Christmas is not designed to be a stressful day, but we've made it that way. And we've made the big happy birthday party for Jesus something that many people dread on the way to it because they feel so pressed about the presence, P-R-E-S-E-N-T, that they are hoping to get and sometimes trouble themselves to give. But it's stressful. And that prayer, boy, that prayer, that Thanksgiving dinner prayer is something we hope calms people down. But then there's some people who are going to be praying to have something to eat as opposed to for thanking. So we go through that vision of opulence, of so much, knowing that there's some people who have nothing, so little. So culturally, you know, that's a clash. How do we deal with that? There's been this big harvest of feelings, information, harvest of presents on Christmas Day. Harvest, what does that remind you of? Well, I'll tell you, we're going to take this break on, very short break, and when we come back, Michael, I'd like for you to talk a little bit about a harvest festival, an invention, a stress reliever, a reminder of our moral obligations, a continuum, cultural continuum of the moral conversation that takes place around Christmas. We're going to take this break. Mr. Michael Harris will come back. We'll talk a little bit about Kwanzaa, which begins on the 26th of December, the day after Jesus' birthday. Very significant. We'll be right back. This is Empire Talks Back. I'm Wallace Allen. Empire Talks Back is brought to you by the Improve Association. My friend, Anthony Garcia, the Mood Master, is here, and he's going to keep us rocking and rolling with a Christmas mood as we go through this. We'll be right back.
That California trip, get your kicks on Route 66.
Publish your legal notice in West Side Story newspaper. For the best service and the best rates, call 909-384-8131. Publishing legal notices in the city and county of San Bernardino since 1990. West Side Story provides friendly expert service. Call 909-384-8131 to benefit from budget-friendly rates. Whether a fictitious business name, a name change, a divorce summons, or any other legal or public notice, call West Side Story Newspaper, 909-384-8131. 909-384-8131. That's 909-384-8131.
Join the Riverside County Black Chamber of Commerce. Enjoy the benefits of membership designed to support and accelerate your business. Make valuable contacts with other professionals, expand your resources and your customers. Update your learning experience via the Chamber's low and no-cost seminars and workshops. Improve your social media impact. The Chamber is dedicated to supporting your unique business needs. Take your first steps to the next level. Join the Riverside County Black Chamber of Commerce. Call 951 951- 951-823-0175. That's 951-823-0175. I'm Pepe Jackson, the president of the Riverside County Black Chamber of Commerce. You have my personal invitation.
Boy, I tell you, Rudolph was on his way.
Run, run, Rudolph!
Rudolph!
To make it in town.
Rudolph is rolling down Route 66, trying to find Rock's Louisiana Fried Chicken and Seafood Restaurant. He was on assignment from Santa Claus. Said, as you fly over the Inland Empire, I want you to take a short run, Rudy. And run by Rock's Louisiana Fried Chicken and Seafood and pick Santa up a plate of gumbo.
Oh, man.
So Rudolph took off on this wild trip trying to find Rock's, and he didn't know that Route 66, the spot right there, Route 66 on Foothill Boulevard in Sierra, that's where Rock's is. Man, I tell you what, he tried to get back to Santa with some stuff he picked up on the corner somewhere else, and Santa, that you didn't hear about that part. You didn't hear about the big Santa and Rudolph split up? Man, I have to tell you about that later. But meanwhile, let me hook you up about Rock's Fried Chicken and Seafood Restaurant. They specialize in seafood and southern cooking. And if you're in the mood for some seafood, like Santa was, the most popular options include crab cakes, fresh fish, oysters, shrimp, po' boy sandwiches, and sometimes gumbo. So if you want to savor some delicious southern food, the menu features a variety of flavorful favorites offering jambalaya, slow-cooked gumbo with rice, and a hearty oxtail dish with rice and gravy. They also have crispy fried chicken, greens, mac and cheese, a lot more. Plus, there's the desserts. I'm not going to go through the list because if you don't get there early, some of them may be gone, especially if it's that peach cobbler that you're wanting. You should be there now, and they're not even open yet. You should be there now ordering your peach cobbler if you want it, because it's going to run out by 2, 3 o'clock. I can guarantee you.
I ordered a peach cobbler a year ago.
Anthony, I'll tell you, you should get there for the peach cobbler. You should drop the guitar, go there right now, and wait in line so we be sure.
I'll go to church.
Oh, you're talking about the other peach cobbler. Listen, get to Rock's by giving them a call at 909-275-3360. Give Rock a call. You'll enjoy the result of that conversation, unless you call too late. Once again, this is Empire Talks Back. I'm Wallace Allen. We are embarking on, you know, one of the great stress reliever weeks and weekends for folks around the planet. We are moving into, we're having Christmas Eve today. Christmas tomorrow, and then we embark upon a cultural explosion known as Kwanzaa that allows us to continue not only that feeling of giving, but, you know, to understand the obligation of getting along with each other. Michael Harris, you are one of my friends who knows a lot more about Kwanzaa than I do, and I would like for you to share a little history of why you, as a agriculturalist, regard and point to Kwanzaa as it is, the harvest festival, and talk about the importance of food and the history and how Dr. Karinga came up on this idea, this mission.
Well, the beautiful blessing to be able to share this California-grown holiday through the unique prism of a young boy from Sacramento. I've been around food and agriculture my entire life, and my parents from the deep south, and particularly my grandma, she was always growing collard greens, okra, speckled butter beans, you know, just a food pantry in my grandma's house in Vallejo, California. But I was introduced to the holiday Kwanzaa by a good family friend, Paula and her husband, Walker Munson. They were educators in our community, and there was a community garden at one of the churches, and then we had Kwanzaa ceremony at their house, and that was 50 years ago. So I've been celebrating Kwanzaa, in a deep dive kind of way, about 23 years ago, mm-hmm. We hosted the founder of Kwanzaa in Sacramento. It's just a blessing. He's still living. His wife, Tia Moyo, is still here. If you want to really learn about Kwanzaa, get his book and read it. And if you have questions, call him and ask it. He's still here living, still teaching. Milana, it means master teacher. He's Dr. Karenga, just an amazing scholar. But this, the idea of Kwanzaa, it is a African tradition to have agricultural celebrations giving first fruits of the harvest. And it's not just one African culture. It's, you know, the vast majority of them. And we're talking about thousands of classical African civilization. We're not just talking about, you know, modern Africa. We're talking about ancient African, classical African civilization, where you get the trade language, Kiswahili. So Mutunda ya Kwanzaa means first fruits of the harvest, and it became a holiday out of the unique California experience called the Watts Riot. So the idea is seven principles, seven symbols, and today it's celebrated on all seven continents in the world.
Now the origination story, the fact that we see the beginning of Kwanzaa as a statement and ultimate holiday or holler-day, because it isn't a day that people so much take away or take off. You don't stop going to work. It's the day after Christmas that the 7 days begin. And New Year's Eve or Freedom Eve is the seventh day, Imani, faith of that's expressed by Kwanzaa. As we talk about the 7 days of Kwanzaa, there's a moral structure or a cultural structure that that each day of celebration takes. Could you walk us through that? And I think I'm sure. Able to. I think the first day is what, unity?
Yes. Yeah, there's it's a blessing to be very simple. And we want to make it confusing, but it's not. This year is 57 years of celebrating Kwanzaa. There's seven symbols, and seven principles, and 7 days. And it's a candle holder with seven candles. And so the first day of Kwanzaa is Umoja, and that's unity. Then we have Kuji Chakalia, and that's self-determination. Third day is Ujima, which is collective work and responsibility. Ujamaa is cooperative economics. Nia is purpose. Kuumba is creativity. Imani is faith. Now, each day, you just break down one principle and you make it interactive. And you talk to the children, and the children show that they're comprehending what Umoja and unity is about, and explain to you from their point of view what unity and how they apply it to their lives. And, you know, you could take a deep dive or you could make it real fun and interactive. But the idea is to ground yourself with that principle. So there's quasi in the home, which to me is far more important because it presupposes that we have these conversations all year round and we have this accountability during the special Kwanzaa season. And then there's community Kwanzaa where we, you know, some people go to their closet and put out a nice African fit and are able to, you know, have an end gathering with community. And we know people that don't wear African clothes only on Kwanzaa, and we know people that wear it. So there's a end gathering of community, and we just know who each others are. But then let me go back. There's seven symbols of Kwanzaa, which is your Kwanzaa, table. And so we have the kanara, which is the candle holder, and it holds the seven principles. And underneath the candle, the kanara is what's called the mkeka, and it's typically it's a straw mat, but it is the foundation that holds up the principles of Kwanzaa.
We're very, very symbolic, and I'd like to talk a bit about the actual importance, the meaning. You know, when we talk about umoja, unity, that's a principle that people talk about all over the world. It's a national prop, but it's very loosely emotionally enforced. The concept of unity, of caring, I mean, I think we see examples of it as we watch our sports, but as we watch our politics, when we watch the Team America that we are representing, I think the concept of Kwanzaa and unity as an African template is a good template for everyone. The idea of taking these seven principles and allowing yourself to improve personally and allowing and pushing our society to improve in its relationship with itself. I'm really amazed at the potential of Kwanzaa, but I also understand how familiarity creates contempt. Since we saw the creation of Kwanzaa, people feel that, since we saw him make that up, it can't be that important. You know, it can't be that impactful. It's not like a religion, and it's not intended to be. It's the way we picked up the use of the computer and programs on the computer is more the way I see how we should, as a group, planet occupiers, look at Kwanzaa and the principles and the idea of coming up with anything that says we should get along better and tells us how to do it. I think it's amazing, and I'm amazed that the world has picked it up like it has. Certainly, the financial beneficiary of it has not been Maulana Dr. Ron Karinga, but it has locked itself into the commercial aspects. And if it's going to work in America, it's got to have some kind of commercial value. So I'm pleased with it. How do you feel about how people are utilizing or taking advantage of or missing out on what Kwanzaa offers?
Well, I'm an eternal optimist and, you know, bold and determined enough. This year we'll be celebrating 25 years of Kwanzaa in and around the California State Capitol. And the idea that you have people that have been kidnapped, taken from Africa, stripped of their culture, to, you know, even have the audacity to want to reclaim their African heritage is something that we, you know, take for granted, don't want to look at. So, yes, Kwanzaa, like all holidays in America, has been commercialized and changed to a degree. But that is a choice on what you choose to do in your home is what Kwanzaa gives it its power and its strength. Some people name their children with African names because if you call a child by an African name or a name that's created that has meaning, you know, it makes a difference. If you wear your hair a certain type of way every day, it makes a difference. If you wear clothing that has meaning and purpose, a cultural purpose, it makes a difference. And prior to Kwanzaa, not so much any of this happening in 1966 in Los Angeles and certainly in places all around the world. So Kwanzaa has a deeper meaning, not being measured by the normal way we measure things, linear and Eurocentric focused. The African focus is far deeper and far more lasting meaning. And, you know, I'll maintain Dr. Karenga, I mean, he's 82 years old. He's still working. He's still the chair of Long Beach State Africana Studies. He's doing what he loves to do. The man's a genius. Writes many books, speaks many languages, and doing what he loves to do. And remember, he was born on a sharecropper's farm in Maryland. Chicken farm. You know, and now he's been the headquarters of the largest educational system in America, Cal State University system, more students than any system that I'm aware of. And the headquarters is at Long Beach State. So, I mean, you know, and he's still married to his wife. They've been together over 50 years, Tia Moyo, and they work together daily. The man has a beautiful life. But the blessing is to look at all the lives, white, black, purple, that he's touched, yes, and say, hey, people of African descent have a wonderful history to stand on and a greater legacy if we come together in unity. And we refuse, most of us, to look at the world through the prism of African culture. We always revert back to worshiping alien cultures that are not ours.
You know, when we look at the physics, which seems to be the truth that planet-wide, we acknowledge as a language that we all speak the same. Physics has some very strong principles that seem to even work for us outside of the planet. Otherwise, we wouldn't be able to be so accurate with our inner space, intergalactic movements that we are involved in, going to the moon, intercepting asteroids, planning to mine asteroids and bring the resources back to Earth. So we're pretty big, but how we come together. You know, one of the things that we have the conflict on, say, like even with Christmas and holidays, is money and morality. Money and can you be happy? You know, I saw something, a game show. Guy says, well, you know, he's got a lot of money, but I'm happy and he's not. Coming together with resources and purposes is really something that we've got to figure out so that those who have not are not left to be victims simply because they have not. And those who have are not crowned as kings and queens simply because they inherited something that their mothers and great-grandparents and someone else worked very hard for. So somewhere in the middle there, we've got to get along and understand that, you know, you may be rich and powerful and have everything in the world, but what happens when the electricity goes out and the guy who's been operating with no electricity, no funds, knows all of a sudden everybody's in the same boat as him? But you threw him out of the boat, made him, anyway. So we got to look for those things. This is Empire Talks Back. I'm Wallace Allen. Our guest today, Mr. Michael Harris, bringing a very important viewpoint to what we do, a historian's viewpoint, a visionary historian. See, visionary historian in that when we come back, Michael, I'd like to talk about the last day of Kwanzaa, which is the 31st of December, which is the first day of, well, it's not the first day of night of Watch Night or of Freedom Eve, but it is Freedom Eve, and we'll talk about why is that? Why is New Year, the 31st of December, such an important cultural day for us? And many of us have no idea about it. We'll be right back after this short break. Kingman, Boston, San Bernardino,
won't you get hip to this timely tip? Publish your legal notice in West Side Story newspaper. For the best service and the best rates, call 909-384-8131. Publishing legal notices in the city and county of San Bernardino since 1990. West Side Story provides friendly expert service. Call 909-384-8131 to benefit from budget-friendly rates. Whether a fictitious business name, a name change, a divorce summons, or any other legal or public notice, call West Side Story Newspaper, 909-384-8131. 909-384-8131. That's 909-384-8131.
Oh, yeah, Mr. Chuck Berry. Mm. Now, he was an innovator. He was not nothing common about Chuck Berry. He was playing rock and roll when everybody else his, who was so melanin-suited was playing what they call race music. Chuck Berry played rock and roll without a doubt, and somehow others have been claimed, named kings and queens of rock and roll. Let's do some date searching. We'll see that Chuck Berry was right out there up front. You know, Michael.
Yes, sir.
I received an email the other day, and the headline on it was, let me get it right, Alabama made $450 million annually from convict leasing, forcing black prisoners to work at fast food chains. A lawsuit filed last week, December 12th. We also had a notice, an email that came in. It's talking about how important it was for us to realize that you know, we still have a problem with human trafficking. There's a national hotline for human trafficking, slavery. It's a 24-hour hotline. Let me say this, we can recognize slavery there. We can recognize kidnapping. It's hard to say. We've got people who've been in trouble, Michael, for seeing what they thought was a strange combination of people, you know, a man with a child that didn't look like his, or a lady with a child that didn't look like theirs. And they've sometimes been very inconvenient because there was an old black lady with a mixed race child, and somebody thought she's kidnapping him, made a report and embarrassed him before they found out that that was her granddaughter. But it's still serious enough to make a mistake. Human trafficking is serious enough that you, okay, maybe I made a mistake. Maybe that is your granddaughter. I'm sorry, but being that it's your granddaughter, you got to be just as happy that there's people out here concerned enough to say, who are you with? Why? How are you with them? But I think when they sent out this human trafficking alert with the hotline, which, by the way, is 888-373-7888. That's 888-373-7888. 7888, the last four numbers. I don't know how to recognize human trafficking. I don't, you know, we need to probably bring somebody on that might have some ideas on that. But I do know how to recognize a situation where if you've got people who are in jail, and we find, unfortunately, that many of the people who are in jail don't need to, you know, didn't really deserve to be there, especially when we're looking at some of the charges against black men. And this situation that we're talking about in Alabama is black prisoners entirely. And that's systematic. Now there's going to be people that say they're in jail. They're supposed to be punished. I don't know. So just off the blind, you're a smart guy. Mike, what do you think about convicts or people who've been put in jail, convicted? And we say convicted, but, you know, every day we say that, you know, if we pay attention, we find that someone who's been convicted. We have a guy that was 50 years in jail in Chicago.
Yeah, from my seat of authority, it is part of our mental illness as a people that we refuse to fully have an adult conversation about how we were brought to this country as prisoners of war. And, you know, for a long time, you know, 15th century until what we know today as Juneteenth holiday, slavery, chattel slavery, was legal. And as we speak right now, the 13th Amendment of the United States Constitution prohibits slavery, allows slavery in the situation if you're incarcerated. So it is legal to enslave people. So I find it a bit, troubling that there is a lack of understanding that slavery is legal. Here in California, they call it involuntary servitude because you've been convicted and you're in jail. And so they pay people 10 cents, less than 50 cents an hour wages because they're incarcerated. But that's legal. So at some point, we have to get some lawyers and change the law. That's what it means to form a more perfect union. So we need to spend more time focusing on the solution than articulate the problem. And so if we have what, like you said earlier, Freedom's Eve, which is the day before the President of the United States issued an executive order to free those that are enslaved in states that are in rebellion, it was an executive order. And then after the war was over, they changed the Constitution to the 13th Amendment. There's been plenty of movies made about it. There's been plenty of conversations about the 13th Amendment. But we have it as a society, as a people of color, given it a priority. Well, because there's only 20,000 people are incarcerated, and then another, let's say, 10,000 or so that are immigrants waiting trial. So if there's, by numbers, it's not very many. But if you're one of those numbers, it's your whole life is destroyed, and then your family, those around you. So it's a big problem.
Yeah.
Number one, you know, institution in the world is California. But not a priority. We don't even celebrate Freedom's Eve by and large anymore. And most people have no idea what it is, why we should celebrate.
Well, that's the whole point. Our existence in America has been pretty much based on the concept of freedom. What is freedom? Freedom is, I don't know. Freedom is anything and everything you want to do until we decide to slow you down, to use you for something other than what you want to be or what you want to do.
There is the challenge. We have the ability. We are the freest people of African descent on the planet.
Well, you got to work for it. You got to work for it. And you brought this up. You hit me with this. I would say, okay, on September 22nd, 1862, Abraham Lincoln signed the Emancipation Proclamation, and black folks had to wait until New Year's Eve. And you said, no, Wallace, wait a minute. They didn't wait. They couldn't wait. Once he signed the Emancipation Proclamation, that lined itself up to assign black colored troops to the war. And there was
even before the troops get involved. See, we have what's called the Underground Railroad to Freedom. People have been self-emancipating and fighting individual battles in a systemic problem from the beginning. And I think Malcolm said it the best, we have people that have been given a frontal lobotomy. They're African people, and they have the only thing African about them is their skin. The rest of them are European, their values, their beliefs, their decisions they make by choice. So we have to change that. And as a historian, we have to what a number of us has decided to do is set the history aside for a minute, because we have to go back to being, we need financial resources to reach the children to give them a better frame of reference early on, and then they will have better outcomes. They don't be broken men and women, as Frederick Douglass says. We have to start with the youngsters and say, look, you could code, you could run your own computer, you could have your own farm in your house, in your backyard, or with community, and have businesses as children. Because the adults, in a lot of situations, have given their authority to the state and to other people. So we don't have African traditions in California. We don't even sit out and have dinner with one another and speak to one another. So we have to change the construct for this next generation intentionally. We need to raise some money to do that and, you know, set the history aside for a little while and focus on cooperative economics.
Let's realize that at the same time that we have big issues, backwards movement, we have forward movement. It's the same time that we say we don't sit down and have dinner together, somebody jumped off the edge of their seat and said, no, we eat together, you know, every night or two or three times a night. The idea that there are certain things that we can do that lead us toward more of a quality of life that allows us to coexist with other people and strive with other people. There's folks who are doing that on an ongoing basis all the time. But there's not enough.
Oh, no. I'm just saying broad strokes. Because, yeah. I mean, you know, I'm just saying, But let's, as a people, we're not doing it. As individuals, yes. So when Dr. King was singing "We Shall Overcome," you know, he was dreaming, right? And by and large, and I'm talking about from sea to shining sea, most people is singing "I Shall Overcome" deep in my heart. I believe I shall overcome, and they don't care about their neighbor. There's no we.
Okay, so once again, and my heart may have skipped a beat when you said that, because it's so true from experiences that I've had, talking to other people, and feelings that I've had. We and I and me and us, get confused sometimes. And when we become more of an I, that causes a problem. So come back again to our joint therapy. This is where we come together with our joint thoughts and common feelings. And going back to now, something that we call New Year's Eve was also a period of time, what represents the last night of a period of time from our initial Emancipation Proclamation date of 9/22/1862 to 12/31/1862. Because on that day, Freedom Eve, we were promised the next day freedom would arrive. On January 1st, 1863, slavery in those particular places that were leveraged for purposes of peace was over. So anticipating that made the 31st of December, Watch Night is one of the things that our churches have called it. People gathered in church to watch and observe the midnight to be Freedom Day. Well, we call it New Year's Day. Well, New Year's is we all come up with the resolutions. It is a new day. It is a new year. It's a new time. It's a time that we throw away our issues of the past. So it is a Freedom Day for everybody who wants to look at it that way. And I think that the African-American experience that says it's a Freedom Day fits in with a European attitude of it's a new day. And there is a commonness at that point where we can come together and actually resolve to do better, to improve. And I have to say, Michael, I was not all the way, you know, that's a story, that's an attitude, but our stories and attitudes become a reality if we stick with them. And I want to thank you for helping me formulate that story in my mind, because I feel better about what's going on in terms of, okay, we have the conflictuous joy of Christmas. We have the opportunity of alignment with self and community during Kwanzaa. We have the ability to take our traditional New Year's Eve, our watch night, our faith night from Kwanzaa, and say we are gathered today in anticipation of a new way tomorrow, New Year's Day, Freedom Day. And we have that opportunity right coming up to us right here in this next 7 days. And you can say, well, how are we going to, I tell you what, on your birthday, the day before your birthday, and I've had quite a few, but the day before my birthday is anticipatory. And on my birthday, it's, I got a new shot. I'm 904. but I got a new shot. And I say all of that to encourage our listeners, to encourage our friends, to encourage ourselves that, hey, man, this is cool. Life is the greatest thing on the planet for us. And no matter how bad it is, we can improve. We can make a short, long, an adjustment to make our lives better. And one of the ways that I suggest we do it is to look somebody in the eye and say, hey, I love you. So don't run out there to the bus stop and grab somebody, look at somebody you never saw before, because they may call the police on you. But people that you know that have been doing for you, and it could be the bus driver, and it could be somebody that's helped you get on the bus because you had been late for the bus and they kind of held the bus up for you or told the bus driver you're coming. So those are, to say I love you is not a sexual statement. So I think it's important that we say it. I think it's important we acknowledge it. So Michael, as we go into this Christmas Eve, we got another minute here for you to tell us what you think is important about heading into this important cultural curve that actually, as we come out of the curve, we're headed into Martin's birthday, Black History Month, Rosa Parks, Black History Month, Women's History Month, Mother's Day, Father's Day, things that give us the opportunity to culturally decompress. How do you feel about all that?
Well, yeah, I think this new year, 2024, is so special in a lot of ways. But the blessing is at the end of the year, we get a chance, you know, in the spirit of Kwanzaa, is to reflect, you know, to really remember what has been in the distant past. And just last year, just last month, a lot of changes. And then recommit to doing some positive things in the new year. So, you know, the idea that we are indeed celebrating the sixth day of Kwanzaa in the spirit of Kuumba, to always do as much as we can in any way we can to leave our community, you know, be creative to leave our community better in the way we found it. So yes, those ancient African concepts are in your DNA. And so the more you bring out what's already within you, the better we'll be. And we won't have to be concerned about what other people are doing. Who is your grandma? Who is your great-grandma? You know, doing your DNA, which is now a requirement if you want some reparations. Who are you? Where'd you come from? You know, I guarantee you, if you black like me, your DNA is not going to be found, you know, on the island of Britain, or they're not going to be, you know, in the mountains of the Himalayas.
Quickest hour probably on radio. Quickest hour on radio. Love you, Michael Harris. I appreciate you very much. Next Sunday is indeed Freedom Eve.
Freedom Eve.
Come join us. That's also... it's not
and
my
most
birthday.
Importantly, get you something to eat, have some freedom in the bowl, and enjoy it.
Very good. See you guys next week under two circumstances. One, if the good Lord's willing. Two, if the creek don't rise. God bless you. Enjoy Christmas. Remember, this is Jesus' birthday. Happy birthday, little Jesus. I appreciate the commitment that you made and the template that you laid. Try to follow it every day. God bless you. Thank you.
KCAA Loma Linda.